Good morning and welcome. It is good to join in worship this morning. If you're visiting with us today, we wish you an especially warm welcome. If you're interested in staying connected with our church, please email us at office@westwooducc.org. You will also find information on our website, westwooducc.org, and you can reach out to us there. Welcome again.
Let us gather ourselves for worship with our centering song.
I heard the voice of Jesus say, "Come unto me and rest. Lay down the weary one, lay down thy head upon my breast. I came to Jesus as I was, so weary, worn, and sad. I found in him a resting place, and he has made me glad. I heard the voice of Jesus.
Give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. Holy One, you gather us here. You bring us together, calling us from all corners of the city, from all parts of the world. You draw us to you, and we bring you all that we are. There is no pain that we carry that you do not know, no trouble we face that you do not see. When our hearts are broken, you heal them. When our souls are cracked, you repair them. When we long to be made over again in your image, you form us once more. You heal us, hold us, and make us whole. And so we give you thanks, asking only that you will help us to take all the healing you have given us and share it with all who have need, this day and all days. Amen.
Our first reading today is from the book of John, Chapter 2, verses 13 through 25. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. When he was in Jerusalem during the Passover festival, many believed in his name because they saw the sign that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, would not entrust himself to them because he knew all people and needed no one to testify about anyone, for he himself knew what was in everyone. And our second reading today is from the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been given, you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Jesus Christ, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Jesus Christ. For you by grace have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing, it is the gift of God. Not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Here ends our reading. May God add understanding.
Would the children come on up to the Zoom screen and join me? And please bring your Lent boxes with you. So we've been looking at different things in the Lent box each week, and here is the one for the day, the clay. You know what's cool about clay? In its most basic form, it kind of looks like a squishy rock, and it feels like really dense mud. But if you take the clay and you work it, and you form it into a shape, and you add some color, and you put it in a hot oven to make it dry and set, you can end up with something like this. Some of you might recognize this bowl because I used to use it for baptizing for a number of years. Ellie Schultz was the first person baptized from this bowl, and there were a bunch of kids and even some adults after her, until one day I came into the sanctuary and I found that the bowl had either fallen or been knocked off of where it was sitting. And instead of finding a bowl like this, I found a bunch of broken pieces of pottery. It's kind of hard to tell from looking at the inside, but on the outside, you might be able to see the cracks. A friend of mine knew how sad I was that our baptism bowl had broken, so she did something really kind. She found an artist who could glue all the pieces back together and cover the cracks with a special kind of coating. She told me I wouldn't be able to put very much water in it, but the repairs would hold so that I could use the bowl for one more baptism, Riley's. Because sometimes things break and they can't be put back together exactly the way they had been. Sometimes our hearts break and God mends them. And sometimes the broken places aren't quite as strong as they were before, but other times they're actually stronger. There are artists in Japan who know how to repair broken pottery with a different kind of glue or coating, a special kind that's mixed with gold or silver or platinum. Laura told me about this last week. And instead of making the cracks disappear, these artists make the cracks stand out like this. These artists feel that breaking and repairing things, that's just a part of the story of an object. It's not something to hide. I wonder sometimes if that's how God feels about us. Sometimes something breaks in our lives, a friendship or a promise, a hope, or our hearts. And we do our best to mend those broken things, to repair them or build them from scratch again. What if God thinks the broken parts are not things to forget, but things to remember? Because most of the time that something breaks, we actually end up learning more than we do in the times that nothing breaks. We learn how to notice what's special, how to fix what's broken, how to take care, and how to remember what we've learned. That's why I keep this baptism bowl. to remember that whatever gets broken in our lives, God will help fix it one way or another. It may not always be exactly the same as it was before, but it might be even more special. Let's pray. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thanks for loving the broken places.
Thanks for loving the broken places.
As much as the places that are still together.
As much as the places that are still together.
Heal the cracks, God.
Heal the cracks, God.
Make us whole.
Make us whole.
Amen.
Amen.
It has been a full year now since I've been able to sing with the kids in our preschool. I record lessons for them and the teachers show them in class, but it is so not the same. Up until last March, I would meet them on the sand yard every Wednesday afternoon. My friend Dale would play his guitar and lead the singing, and I would teach the kids some songs that I learned when I was their age. This Little Light of Mine and Peace Like a River and Kumbaya, actions to all of them. One of their favorites is the one about the wise man and the foolish man. If you know this, go ahead and sing along. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came tumbling down. And then we do the actions and sing about how the rains came down and the floods came up, but the house on the rock stood firm. And then they get and they show me how strong they are. That's one of their favorite parts. And then we sing the verse about the foolish man who built his house upon the sand. And the rains came down and the floods came up and the house on the sand went smash. That's their very favorite part. Preschoolers love that big dramatic moment. And someday they'll come to understand that it's all a metaphor for life and for faith. I love the image of each of our lives as a house. I love the idea that we sometimes make choices about where and how we build those lives on shifting sands or stable ground. And sometimes those choices are made for us by other people or by just existence. If you think about it, this is a metaphor that works for our own individual lives ourselves, but it works just as well for whole countries or communities. Our bodies may be houses, and so may our souls. In today's passage from John, Jesus even says that his own body is a temple, a house, God's home in the world. And he tries, as he always does, to explain what it means that this house is about to be broken. In the same way that the money changers and loan sharks have broken the temple, so shall his own body be torn apart in ways that people always struggle to understand. What do we do when the house breaks? The house of our lives, the house of our nation, the house of our own bodies or souls. Once we've seen it, recognized it, know where the brokenness lies, what do we do about it? Sometimes it's only little things that break, like a cracked window or peeling paint, a mistake that we make at work, an argument with a loved one, things that can be repaired somewhat simply. I knew somebody once who said that nothing was really a problem if it could be fixed with money or a kiss. I suppose it depends on how much money you have or how many kisses. Sometimes, though, we can just fix the mistake that we made. We can apologize for what we have done. We can offer forgiveness to another and move on. But what happens when we discover that the structures of our lives are broken, that it's not just a matter of individual broken acts by broken people, but the whole context in which we're living, the overarching constructions? What happens when we've discovered that there are cracks in the very foundation, a betrayal in relationship, a fractured sense of self, injustices as old as our nation, the kinds of fundamental breaks that must be mended before anything else can ever get fixed for good? possible, of course, to try to just patch up those kinds of cracks. Sometimes that patching can even last for some years, but it's unlikely to fix the underlying problem. Some of the cracks we simply overlook accidentally or on purpose. They don't seem big enough to cause real problems. They're just tiny fissures. How bad could they be? But over time, they grow and spread and eventually cause the foundation and even the house itself to disintegrate. My friend Naomi tells the story of the time her front door started sticking. She lives near the ocean and she figured it probably was just the weather or the moisture in the air. But the problem didn't get better. It actually got worse. In a few weeks, she had to really push to get the door open. A few weeks after that, she had to kind of bump really hard with her hip. And soon after that, she had to back up and throw herself at the door to force it open. Not long after that, she gave up and just started coming in and out through the back door. All the while, Naomi kept thinking that she should really call the handyman to come over and fix the door. Until one day, a friend came over and noticed something funny. If you set an exercise ball down in the middle of the living room, the ball would automatically roll toward the front door. If you placed the ball in a different part of the room, the ball would roll toward the front door. No matter where in the room you placed the ball would roll toward the door. Taking Naomi outside, the friend showed her the cracks above the front door and running along the base of the wall. Turns out it wasn't the door that was broken. It was the house. When Naomi finally called the handyman, he took a look under the house and discovered that all the wooden beams were rotting and literally crumbling. The house was falling off of the foundation. There was so little clearance that the workers had to dig a tunnel under the house and remove all the dirt so they'd have space enough to work. Then they actually jacked up the front end of the house like you do when you change a tire on a car, so they could replace all the rotted beams. I know that for a homeowner, this costs an unbelievable amount of time and money in a place that nobody will ever see. It's not nearly as fun as a new kitchen. But frankly, I think it's pretty amazing that they were able to fix the house. In another time, they probably would have had to tear it down and start over. Some things can be repaired. Others have to be completely reconstructed. The best way out is always through, wrote Robert Frost. To heal what's broken, we first have to recognize it. And then we have to walk into it. Walk, crawl, climb, whatever. I know, it's nuts. What rational human beings look at what's broken in their lives and decide to go into the falling down house rather than out. But that is what it takes, to look at our brokenness square on and walk right in the door. We have to let ourselves experience every part of what is broken. We have to feel all the grief, express all the anger, cry all the tears, be as desperate or despondent as we feel. Because the more we feel those feelings, the ones nobody wants to feel, the faster we get through them. Every time we try to ignore them or avoid them, push them away or hide them, they only get bigger and grow stronger and wait for the moment when we stop being vigilant. And then in the very worst possible time, they come rising up again, rushing out, spilling over onto those around us, breaking more things and more people. I know it sounds counterintuitive, that the way to heal what's broken is to let it break, that we do that before it heals. But it's actually right there in what Jesus is saying in this passage of John. Look, Jesus says, this temple is breaking. The one around you and the one right before you, both of them are coming apart. And it is only by going all the way into this brokenness that what's broken can be fixed. The only way out of my death, Jesus says, is through it. The only way out of your loss, your grief, your trauma, your pain is through it. Only by walking in can we walk through. Only by walking through can we come to the other side. when we go in, we can repair what has cracked. When we go through, we can reconstruct what has crumbled. It's a scary prospect at times, which is why the Ephesians passage is here for us, to remind us that no matter where it is we have to go, what kind of brokenness we have to face, what sort of tiny spaces we must crawl through, we never, ever do it alone. God walks with us. God walks with us. And we walk with God. In his commentary on this portion of Ephesians, scholar Kyle Fever talks about the Greek word used in the first verse of this passage, peripatou. Some have translated it as following, but it can also mean walking, or as the same word is interpreted in verse 10, way, the framework of faith in which we live and move and have our being. Fever explains, the idea might be equivalent to the house in which we live and make our dwelling. We set up a house according to our everyday living habits and preferences. It's not just the way of the house, it provides the structure of our lives. When we lived in a different house, a broken house, Paul says, it was like we were dead, broken. But when we live in God's house, we are made alive, not just alive, but reconstructed, not just a new person in a patched up, propped up house, but a new person in a whole new kind of dwelling, rebuilt into a space of grace. We don't do the reconstruction or even the small repairs on our own. We don't have to. We just have to walk the path all the way and let God walk it with us. And somehow, in walking through the brokenness, we find that God repairs the cracks, that God reconstructs what is crumbled. And if there are a few things that don't quite get fixed, God finds a way to soften them and quiet them and show us how to invite them into our homes, as the Lakota would say, to make them our relatives, to live with what is broken until it is ready to be healed. In the repair, through the reconstruction, and even living with the relatives, we are broken open. Thanks be to God, who makes it so. Amen. Listen now as our musicians sing for us, Rise Up.
You're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the fire, but I see it in you, so we're gonna walk it out. Thank you.
Throughout the past year, we've often felt like we were all on our own. Even before COVID, some of us have struggled to remember to ask God for help. Many of us have wanted to handle everything ourselves, as if we could be the ones to bring out about our own healing all on our own. Perhaps the greatest lesson of this year has been the realization of how deeply we need one another, how truly we have come to see that none of us can repair all of our own broken places. And we were never meant to. We were always meant to turn to each other, giving and receiving courage and compassion. We were always meant to turn to God, the source of our strength, who makes us whole. Let us join our hearts together as we continue in prayer. Holy One, hear the cries of our hearts, we pray. Hear the whispers within us and also the screams. Come and be with us in all our broken places, and especially be with those who need you the most. Especially be with those who don't even know how to ask. Especially be with those who have reason not to trust that anyone will be there for them. Come and be there for them. Let us be there for them. A reflection of your presence, of your love and your grace. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. For all the petitions that have been shared, we know that others are still quiet in our hearts. Let us take a moment now to lift them up silently as we rest in God's care.
We join now in praying together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Sunday, March 8th, 2020. I had been on the deacons for about 6 months and had only been co-chair for a couple months with Larry. And we commenced to have a very in-depth, concerned discussion about how we were going to handle communion. This continued into council. This continued into a flurry of emails throughout the week. Ultimately culminating on Thursday, March 12th, in Kirsten emailing the congregation to let us know that we would not be meeting that Sunday. It also happened to be the same day that Michael defended his thesis. The last day, he was the last person to defend his thesis in person on campus. And he immediately afterwards got in his car, packed up as much as he could, and drove from San Diego to Los Angeles to spend the remainder of the lockdown with me in Los Angeles. I had planned on having a birthday celebration, going to a drag king show in Long Beach. That quickly became clear that that was not possible. Instead, I had friends over my apartment because as of Saturday, the California government still recommended that gatherings under the size of 20 were safe. And we had less than 20 people in my apartment. So it's been a year. And looking back on it, this year, I had friends over at a park last Saturday. Or yesterday. And some people still didn't feel comfortable attending in a large group, despite the outdoor setting and masks, which of course I respect. One friend was not able to attend because she was giving vaccines out. Another friend attended for a brief time, and then an alarm went off and he had to leave to go get a vaccination. And a friend commented to me about how circular and poetic it was that everyone who attended that party continued saying to me throughout the year that it marked the beginning for them. It was the last time they were able to see a group of people without masks before we even knew how safe masks were, feeling relatively safe. We were still in this weird in-between space of asking whether hugs were okay with each other, of not necessarily shaking hands, of being careful about sharing food, of washing our hands for 30 seconds, all of that. And here we are a year later, and I am both hopeful and also sort of sad that we're still here and not fully together. But those 3 weeks of church emails, of jumping on Zoom calls and testing, seeing if we can do this, if we can do that, what is it going to look like? I had been signed up to do a sermon that I had planned for Harry Potter and Easter. I had a lot of things planned. And I called Kirsten and I was like, do you think that I am the best person to hear from right now? I feel like people need you. I feel like people need your expertise, Kirsten, not mine. But she convinced me I was wrong and that I was the voice that people needed to hear. And it was the first time we had music with the sermon, and I wanted Gather Us In, because it's a song I know, it's a song that's special to me. And a lot of people remarked on how special it was to them too. So Kirsten style, I whipped up a sermon in about 2 days. And, you know, here we are again. And so, having been a year with a light at the end of the tunnel, this church has been a fixture in that year of coming regularly, of having a place to come and share our grievances, our pain, our comforts, our joys, and everything that has happened over the past year. And we will continue to do so as the deacons now go through the reverse process, hopefully in the next few months, of planning what it looks like, as Jamie mentioned, to go back. And we're all very excited for that day. Thank you all so much. And the morning offering will now be collected. You can send in a check. You can also give online. Brad has placed the link in the chat. Thank you.
Let us hear and even join our musicians as they sing for us. Love heals.
Reveals life.
Can I get an amen? Amen. Now, as we prepare for the benediction, I invite you to hold your hands up to the edges of your Zoom box. Let us be palm to palm. Let us be together and remember that we are one. People of God, walk all the way through your brokenness, for God walks with you, repairing your heart, renewing your soul. Amen.
Oh.